If you've got a basic understanding of standard deviation, you can use your knowledge to understand z-scores, which you will find used frequently in research. This video will focus on defining z-scores and helping you understand the basic concept of z-scores. Let's start with a few definitions. The first definition describes the usage of the z-score as the standard score used most frequently by researchers. While this really doesn't tell us much about what the z-score does, it does tell us that understanding the z-score is important because as researchers, we are likely to use it frequently. Z-scores are useful for comparison purposes. They allow for comparisons of individual data points within a data set. The second definition is a little more enlightening. A standard score, or standard normal deviates, that provide a common unit of measurement that indicates how far a particular score is away from its mean. This tells us that we are interested in comparing a particular score against the mean, or the average, of a group of scores. You've probably noticed the words standard score repeated in both of these definitions. That's because the z-score is sometimes called the standard score. In essence, when you convert a particular score to a z-score, you are standardizing the scores. One of the benefits of standardizing scores is that you can compare two scores that are from different normal distributions. A quick example. Assume you are comparing grades across two tests that you took. You earned 75% on both tests. For the first test, the professor announced that the average grade was 70%. As you notice that your score was only 5 points higher than the average, and as you pride yourself on being the best in the class, your stomach drops as you see that 75% on your paper. But let's assume that when taking the entire class into account, your score of 75% is actually one of the highest scores in the class. In fact, in your score of, say, 100 students, 95% of the scores ranged between 68 and 72%. The scores were very similar and clustered together. So while your score is actually much better than the average, it doesn't appear to be that great. For the second test, however, assume the class average was also 70%. This time, however, assume the scores for the exam were all over the place. The average of 70% was due to several students who earned 95% or higher, and a few students who just bombed the test completely. In this case, 95% of the scores were between 30 and 90%. Now, when compared to the rest of the class, your 75%, which was still above the arithmetic average, isn't quite so good. By standardizing your score in relation to the class average, or the mean, you have a better idea how you performed. And that's where z-scores come into play. Think of the z-score as a statistical measurement of a score's relationship to the mean in a group of scores, how you really did when compared to the rest of your classmates. Z-scores measure the distance between a particular score and the mean. It's really explaining how many standard deviations a score is away from the mean. Let's do a quick review of standard deviation, which should help you better understand z-scores. Assuming you have a normal distribution, the mean would of course be in the center. As the whole curve encompasses 100% of the scores, this means that 50% of the scores in the distribution are higher than the mean, and 50% of the scores are lower. Another way to say it is that the probability of a score being above the mean is 50%, while the probability of a score being below the mean is 50%. You'll recall that at the mean, the standard deviation is zero. For our example, you can also think of the standard deviation as a z-score, so the z-score at the mean is zero. You'll also recall that in a normal distribution, about 34% of the scores would be within one standard deviation above the mean, and about 34% of the scores would be within one standard deviation below the mean. Taken together, this means that there is a 68% probability that a score is within one standard deviation of the mean. All the scores to the right of the mean, as they are higher than the mean, when converted to z-scores, are positive, and all of the numbers below the mean, or to the left, are negative. A magic number often used in statistics is 95%. If you want to capture 95% of the scores in a normal distribution, the scores would be within slightly less than two standard deviations of the mean, or more specifically, plus or minus 1.96 standard deviations, meaning that there is a 95% probability that a particular score is within 1.96 standard deviations of the mean. Look back at our example. For the first test, when the scores were all clustered together around the mean, if you calculated a standard deviation, you would end up with a fairly small number. While for the second test, with the scores more spread out, the standard deviation would be larger. Why this slight detour down memory lane? Because the standard deviation plays a major role in z-scores. In fact, it is, in essence, a z-score. So let's get back to what we said earlier, that z-scores measure the distance between a particular score and the mean. That means that as long as we have the mean of a distribution and the standard deviation, we can convert any score to a z-score, meaning we can figure out how many standard deviations a particular score is away from the mean. A z-score of, say, 1.5 is 1.5 standard deviations away from the mean, above the mean. A z-score of negative 0.5 is actually half a standard deviation away from the mean, below the mean. And a z-score of 0 is actually located at the mean. Oh, and of course you would need the formula. You could see this formula written in a variety of ways depending upon if you are calculating z-scores in a sample or in a population. They all mean the same thing: the score minus the mean of the distribution divided by the standard deviation. So all you need to know to calculate a z-score is the score you're interested in, the mean of the distribution, and the standard deviation for that distribution. Processing time. What can z-scores be used for? They allow researchers to compare individual data points within a data set. And what would you need to be able to calculate a z-score? You need the score you want to convert, the mean for the distribution, and the standard deviation for the distribution. Oh, and of course, you'll need the formula. Hopefully, you now have a basic understanding of what z-scores are and why you might need to calculate them. Your next step, then, is to take what we've just talked about and put it into practice. Time to calculate.